Welcome to Curator with a Camera. I'm Anthony Coulls, Senior Curator at the National Railway Museum, and we're here at King's Cross Station in London to look at the icon of steam, Flying Scotsman. King's Cross is a classic location, and here there's two absolutely splendid developments of rail technology. On the left, the LNER Pacific A3 Flying Scotsman, and on the right, the Azuma Hitachi 800 series, high-speed train for the LNER. Now, there's 100 years separates them, and yet they're machines made for the same purpose. Let's have a look at Flying Scotsman and see what made it the absolute star that it's become. Why is it famous? Well, quite often people say it's famous for being famous. Flying Scotsman burst onto the scene in 1924, but the frames of it were laid down in 1922. In 1923, it was put into service without a name and as number 1472 in the newly created London and North Eastern Railway, the LNER. The railway were looking for a locomotive to send to the British Empire Exhibition in 1924 at Wembley. And they chose this engine. And in time for it to appear at Wembley, it was named Flying Scotsman. After the 10 o'clock service from here, King's Cross, to Edinburgh, by naming their newest locomotive after the crack express train, this engine was given a place in popular history forever. So there's lots of books about Flying Scotsman that'll tell you its history, tell you the story of it, how it's traveled the world, it's circumnavigated the globe, it's been across Australia, America, first engine to do 100 mile an hour authentically, non-stop run from London to Edinburgh. But what is it that makes it tick? What actually is this machine that Nigel Gresley and his team designed and put together in 1922-23? Well, it's a Pacific locomotive. That means the wheel arrangement, there's four small wheels at the front, six feet eight diameter driving wheels, and then what's called a pony truck at the back end supporting this massive firebox. So this engine is driven by three steam cylinders. One on either side, you can't see the other side today, and a third in the middle, whose steam valves are actuated by what's called a 2-to-1 lever in an ingenious combination created by Harold Holcroft. So this engine, whilst it bears Gresley's name as the designer, has an input of many people, many draftsmen, many engineers who made it what it is. Now, we move along the loco, and you can't help but notice these smoke deflectors, these elephant ears, these troughs on either side of it. It wasn't built like that. It managed most of its working life from 1923 to 1959 without these. But with the changes of coal quality in the 1950s, there were experiments in the drafting of the front end, and the engine could burn inferior quality coal with a double chimney. But that softened the blast, the chuff that came out of the top of the engine, and the smoke drifting along the top of the boiler became a problem because it obscured the driver and the fireman's views. So these German pattern, they call them Vita smoke deflectors, were fitted to lift the smoke up above the boiler and take it out of the view of the driver and fireman. So the engine didn't always look like this. We've represented it today in the form in which it left British Railways service in 1962. And it bears its final number, 60103, which is the number that British Railways gave it in 1948. So Flying Scotsman is known quite often as 4472. But before that, it started life as 1472. During the war, it became 502, then E103. Sounds like a food colouring, doesn't it? And then finally 60103 under British Railways. So it's also been all sorts of different colours. So it started in the apple green of the London North Eastern Railway, went during the war, the Second World War, to wartime black for economy and austerity, Then it was apple green again for British Railways. And it was blue for a time, really quite a striking experimental blue for a couple of years in the early 50s. And then it finished in this quite classy BR dark green, which is, many have said it's a bit like British Racing green. It's also Land Rover green if you're into that sort of thing. So moving along, there's a lot of features of this engine that still would have been around when it was new, but it was built as what was called an A1 class locomotive. That meant that whilst it outwardly looked very similar to this, there were a lot of detail differences. The boiler pressure was lower, the steam dome was higher, the chimney was higher, the cab was higher. And the engine's been rebuilt successively over the years, and in 1946 was converted into what's called an A3 with a higher pressure boiler, this banjo dome on the top, and a number of other changes. And in 1953, it was also converted to left-hand drive. So whilst it's still Flying Scotsman, it's a collection of parts that bear that identity. So very little of this engine actually goes back to 1923. One of the bits that is left, I can't remember which one it is, but one of these beading on the splashes here, one of these, at least one, is brass, which was a special show finish that it was fitted with for the Wembley exhibition. Likewise, parts of the bottom of the cab side are also original from 1923, but the boiler's been changed, the frames have been replaced, even the nameplates aren't original. But like Grandad's broom, it's still Flying Scotsman. 100 years old in 2023, still operating on the national network in steam. That's again where there've been various changes to make this loco fit to operate on the national network. You can see here concessions to operating in the 21st century, the danger of the overhead live wires. That's because those cables up above the boiler all carry 25 kilovolts. It's a lot of electric. And I better not wave this thing any higher because we will actually get people quite concerned about us getting close to the wires and the cables. But, you know, this engine can still run on the national network. It's been altered, so it's got air brakes that enable it to operate with modern carriages. But in essence, this principle of boiling water to make steam, to make the loco run, it's still just what it was in 1923. It can run at 75 miles an hour, and it can do that for miles at a time. And that's testimony to the mechanics of it. These wonderful 6'8" driving wheels, you know, they allow that engine to run for miles at a time at speed along the East Coast Main Line. But then there's little details as well, like the mechanical lubricator on the running plate and the sandbox, the lid for the sandbox, so you can refill it and sand drops down by steam. You can start to see the steam jet on the sander just down there. So that as the engine is digging in to get a grip, as it pulls the heavy train out of King's Cross up through Gasworks Tunnel, Copenhagen Fields, the engine is able to accelerate smoothly and powerfully and be able to put all that horsepower, that steam energy, to effective use. But what's it like on the footplate? It's always great to get into these locos and have a look-see and see what's going on and find out the atmosphere. And it's really nice to be able to do this with a live engine today. So let's go and talk to the man who's driven Scotsman. Whilst I've had the great privilege of being able to fire this engine on several occasions, I've never actually driven it. So for this part of Curator with a Camera, we're going to have a chat with Clive from our workshop and traction team, who's been there, done that, and isn't wearing the t-shirt, but he's got the tie on today. So Clive, do you want to take us through what it's like to drive this thing?
It's a real pleasure. It's a privilege. The engineering side of it and the history is phenomenal. Picking up what Andy was saying earlier on, because we're working on a modern railway and heritage, we've got the modern equipment with the GSMR radio there on the tender front, which is the global radio signalling system that you can use. It's got TP2S and AWS on it, like the modern units, which is a safety system related to the signalling and the control of trains. And then it's got all the normal, what you'd expect to see on any steam engine. We've got a pair of gauges there that show you the boiler water level. We have a firebox, which is 42 square feet of grate to burn the coal, create the steam. The fireman has the privilege of moving the coal and making the steam so we can move along. He's got controls over damper door, the injectors, and then for the driver, he gets all the fun of the braking system, which has been modified on this one to air brakes, but it can run vacuum trains, but the actual engine's air braked. They've got the reverser here for forward and backwards and altering the cutoff to make it economical to run, use the steam expansively. That's the regulator handle, and of course we've got the magic whistle, which everybody wants to blow, including Anthony.
So we're on a live steam loco, Clive, and it's a bit like a toy box. We've just played with the whistle, but everybody wants to have a look in the fire. Can we have a look in
Let's
the box,
Let's have a look
please?
In the firebox.
Yeah, lovely job. So there we are. Not a huge amount in there today because we aren't going anywhere. Try not to melt the GoPro on the plate. And you can see the brick arch also in there, which deflects the gases and ensures complete combustion. But should we drop it down again, mate?
The new brick arch.
The new brick arch, yes. Can't have a second-hand brick arch.
Part of the overhaul.
So there we go. Flying Scotsman at King's Cross. It doesn't get any better than this. And it's really quite something that we can celebrate 100 years of this locomotive, built in 1923, but operating on a national network in 2023. But Flying Scotsman is more than the most famous steam locomotive in the world. It's an absolute flag bearer for industrial, transport and engineering heritage. Whether you're an engineer or a school child meeting it for the very first time, this thing is magic and it appeals to all ages on so many different levels. What a fantastic tribute to the people who designed it, made it, operated it, saved it for preservation, overhauled it for us all to enjoy across the UK in this very special year. Thanks for joining us at King's Cross for a fantastic Curator with a Camera. I hope you've enjoyed it as much as I have. If so, please like and subscribe so you don't miss out on future episodes.